Thank you very much. When you are ill in hospital, you need good, wholesome food, and it's important that you have a choice. A system of menu cards has helped in many hospitals, where you mark the card with the food you want. But you still have to order up to 24 hours in advance, and by then you mightn't be feeling so good, or you might have even been discharged. And that's meant a wastage of up to 20% of the food in some hospitals. Now, I ordered my lunch this morning, and this omelette was cooked in the kitchens just 6 minutes ago. The process has, of course, been computerised. Of course, the computer has nothing to do with the actual cooking, but it greatly speeds up the counting of the dishes on the 500 menu cards. The patients benefit, and so do the chefs, who now know the precise quantities to be cooked. The computer the catering team chose can be bought in any high street computer shop, and it's small enough to fit on an office desk. For the operator, the system couldn't be easier to use. Getting the information into the computer is also easy. An optical card reader scans each card and detects the mark that the patient has made opposite his choice. But the computer can do more than just gather information about the number of dishes and meals. It can help the catering manager plan and cost the menus. Or, if it's given the exact recipe of each dish, even down to the last pinch of salt, it will print out the shopping list the chef needs to take to the stores.
Dish recipe code. So let's have an MC012, which happens to be the beef goulash.
What's more, if the computer's programmed with the price of each commodity, it can combine that with the shopping list and tell the catering manager the total cost of the day's meals, or the cost per patient, or indeed the total cost of any of the ingredients used in the kitchen that week.
And on the printer, out comes an analysis of how much that dish is going to cost.
The day-to-day running of the catering office is also greatly assisted by the computer. It's available to any of the staff who need it, and the information it can give them is only limited by the ingenuity of the programs they feed it. What started as a simple aid to reading menu cards has proved to be far more valuable because of its ability to process and retrieve information. What the computer has also proved are that soggy chips are no longer the order of the day, because we know from the printout exactly how many portions of chips are needed on each of the 30 wards. We can divide them into groups of five and cook the chips in batches, exactly the right amount just before they're needed. The key to the whole operation is this timetable. It's almost military in its precision, and it's adhered to rigorously. 12:58 is the time the next lot of things are due to leave for the wards. Hospital, they've had the computer system running for just 2 years, and it's paid for itself over and over again. It's now being installed at hospitals all over the country, and that means savings of hundreds of thousands of pounds of taxpayers' money every year.
Obviously a tremendously valuable thing for any hospital to have, but one thing I want to know about computer memory. It's you put stuff into storage and then you get stuff out. How does that really work, that business?
Well, in basic you have things called variables, and all that a variable really is the location in memory where your data is being stored. You don't have to know exactly whereabouts in memory it is located. The computer looks after that for you. All you have to remember is the variable that you've called it. And I think if you take a visit to memory, or in this case a bank vault, you get a rough idea of what I mean. In a bank vault, you give them your name, they may look at a list, and they'll come out with a number where your worldly wealth is located. In exactly the same sort of way, in BASIC, you give it a variable and you name it, and the computer will decide where it's to be located in memory, and whenever you give it that variable name, it goes to that location and pulls it out. It has no idea what's in there, but it just knows that when you give it that variable name, it goes to that position in store and takes the contents out, or copies of them, and gives them to you.
So just like the bank vault, the bank don't know what you've got in your box, so the computer doesn't know what's in that memory. And You don't know where the computer's located that particular bit of information until you want it and the computer goes and finds it for you.
That's precisely correct. And like a bank, when you give your name, you always get what's in that box.
Right.
Well, we put together a little database here of four of your friends and their birthdays.
Mm-hmm.
And we're calling these variables. Name one with this curious dollar sign, which I hate, which says it's a string. Mm. In other words, alphabetic and numeric, but not to be calculated on. But name one, and Jane, is the contents of the memory location which the computer knows as name one. So you say name one, you're going to get Jane.
Right.
Date one is another variable name. And the contents of that location is 23rd of February, and so on down the thing, with name 2 be Mike, date 2 being the 15th of June, and so on.
Fine. The next bit I'm sure I can work out for myself. I mean, that's asking the computer, when you run the program, to write up on the screen, enter keyword. That's,
right.
That's telling you, as the operator, to start.
Exactly.
Okay. And input item string.
Now, you remember that, because then the computer comes back to you with a little question mark, which is saying, it's expecting some input from you. And when you type that in, it's going to know that as item. It's going to call that piece of information item.
Okay, so it's going to be 70 next, I guess. Am
70.
I right?
Now, I hope you're going to be able to work this one out. Well, what you've got in there now is item. So if the item
I thought it was going to be one. It's going to be one of these, if something equals something, then
right.
something or other.
So if item dollar symbol is equal to name one.
Item string. Right. Equals, I bet.
Equals name one.
Right. Then?
Then we want to print her birthday.
Right.
So then print date one.
And you have to say then, because that's
right.
its language.
That's part of BASIC.
Print is part of its language.
Right. Date one with the dollar.
Date one. And the dollar sign means
it's a
string of numbers and letters, not something that's going to be calculated.
Correct.
With. Right. Okay. Then print date one strings, all right?
Now, obviously, we've got to do that for everyone, the way we've written this program, for every one of the pieces of data. But we've got a little program which we've written
on cassette. Well, that saves a lot of time. Otherwise, it could be flogging through all the...
Yes, we'd have to type them on at the moment. Right. Now, what we're doing, in fact...
Now, load we've got
load
to do, haven't we?
Dates, I've called the program, in quotation marks.
Start the tape. Press the return button. And there it's searching, right.
What we're doing effectively is very much the same sort of thing that was happening when you typed space shuttle.
Yes.
It went to seek in for the locations in space shuttle and bring that into the terminal. Let's just list 70 to 100 and you'll see the what we've added to it. Those are the logic statements there.
Oh, yes.
Connecting name two, if item is name two, then print date two. If item is name three, print date three. If name four, print date four.
Right.
Let's see if it works.
Run. Now, I've forgotten all my friends' names that you made up.
Try Mike.
Jane was one
Jane,
of them.
That's right. 23rd of February.
Well, we'll try another one. What was another name? Mike you said?
Yes.
15th of June. Very good.
That's not bad.
Works.
It's ended rather abruptly, of course, and you could enhance the program by putting their addresses on or putting what you sent them last year for their birthday as a present. And it's almost limitless what you could do to this database.
That's all feasible as a natural expansion on a microcomputer like this.
To yes.
Have
yes.
a big home database.
Totally feasible.
Right. Well, it's pretty clear then that given a few more lessons and a bit of practice, I could have access to quite a lot of stored information. But some of it could be beyond the four walls of my home computer. Out there in computer land, as we've seen, there's a vast amount of stored data, and much of it surprisingly easy to get at. Now, that accessibility is something people are beginning to worry seriously about, including journalist Rex Malik.
What we do with computers has always depended on the cost of storage. Well, the cost of storage is becoming trivial so that we can all hold almost any data we like on a computer. Does this mean that there's a kind of electronic big brother waiting out there in the future? Well, yes, I'm afraid there probably is. For the technology is now beginning to place awful temptations in front of administrators. Do it fast, do it easily, do it cheap. What we need is law, custom, and procedure. We need to be able to control what is held on computers, who has access to it, and how they can use it. And we need to be able to correct the record. What worries me is not that Big Brother will get it right, but that he'll get it wrong. The trouble is that people tend to believe what computers tell them. Well, they shouldn't. There's a more than 20-year-old rule in this game, and the sooner everybody memorizes it, the better. It's garbage in, garbage out.
This BBC publication, entitled The Computer Book, which explains what computers do and how they work, is available from bookshops, price £6.75. For details of the BBC microcomputer and software, the associated NEC correspondence course in programming, or of computer club courses and other sources of local information, please send a stamped addressed envelope at least 12 inches by 9 inches to Broadcasting Support Services, P.O. Box 7, London W3 6XJ, and please indicate clearly what information is required.